They speak of a great Savior, but they speak of a people who are in great need. Aren't you glad to be here this morning?
Amen.
It's a good place to be. It's a good family to be a part of. There's so many great things that are going on here at the church in Corona. So many things in which we're involved that are really transforming the lives of others. And what a great ministry we have here. And if you're visiting with us, this is a great time to really get involved and to really know what the church is all about and what it is that drives us here in Corona. So thank you for being here. And I pray that this morning you would be encouraged by the things that you see and hear, and maybe even just a little challenged by some of the things that you see and hear, and prompting maybe some questions as to what we do and why we do it and what the Bible is talking about. The Bible says something really spectacular in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and in verse 8. Paul is writing to the Thessalonians, and he understands that they're undergoing some persecution, that they're being mistreated, and that they're facing some severe difficulties. And so Paul is writing to them. He's trying to encourage them, and he's letting them know that God is going to deal with those who are mistreating them. God will take care of that. But not only that, God will take care of them. He looks at their persecutions from an interesting perspective. And he sees the blessing in the persecutions, because he says that God is really working for their faith throughout these persecutions. And so he says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 8, when he looks at those who are doing the persecuting, Paul says that God will deal out retribution to those who do not know God and to those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God will deal out retribution to those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He goes on in verse 9 to talk about the retribution that will take place and how there will be this eternal destruction. There will be this eternal separation from God. And it all looks toward the appearing of Jesus. It looks toward His coming again. And He said, those who do not know God, those who don't love God, will be separated from Him when He comes, facing eternal destruction. And always separate from God. And so I think within this verse, within the context here, Paul reveals two needs that every human being has. Every person in this room has these two needs. The first is to know God. In John chapter 17 and verse 3, Jesus says that knowing God is eternal life. He says, this is eternal life, knowing you, the only true God. John 17, that's the Lord's Prayer. He's praying to the Father the night before he's handed over to be arrested, tried, crucified. And he's praying to God, and he says, this is eternal life, knowing you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. That's eternal life. That is one of our greatest needs, is to know God. Because God will deal out retribution to the people who don't know Him. You ever think about this? You ever get the idea that you really think you know somebody? And then you learn something and you realize, I did not know them as well as I thought I knew them. You ever have that feeling? And we say the phrase, you think you know somebody, right? See, that's kind of the way it is with our knowledge of God. We think we know God, but that knowledge needs to continue growing. We're going to talk more about that in the next hour in Bible class and the growing discipleship and how we grow in our knowledge of God. But that's one of our great needs, is to know God and to know Him on an ever-growing, ever-deepening level, never satisfied that we think we know Him completely. And if you don't know Him in a way that identifies the retribution He will deal out to those who don't know Him and those who don't obey His gospel, then we really don't know God. And that brings up the second need. Every person in the world has a need to obey the gospel. Because without knowing God and without obeying the gospel, we face that retribution. We face that destruction. We face that separation that keeps us apart from God. Isaiah 59 verses 1 and 2 poses some powerful questions. And Isaiah asks, is the arm of the Lord so short that he cannot save? Is the ear of the Lord so dull that he cannot hear? And then he provides the answers in verse 2. And he says, no, God's arms aren't so short, and God's arms aren't so dull, or God's ears aren't so dull, but your sin has separated you from your God. And because that sin separates us from God, there's a need to know Him and to obey His gospel. And so I want to take a look at that this morning. I want to take a look at really three different ideas here. If you're going to obey something, you have to know what it is you're going to obey. And so I want to spend some time looking at what, why, and how we obey the gospel. When we look at the what, everybody likes their kids to be obedient, don't you? Yeah. Parents? See, you get a resounding amen. People like for their kids to obey them. They like for them to do what they're told. But listen to this. How can you obey if you don't know what you're being instructed? If you don't let them know how to obey you. That's the idea of the what. That's the idea of what is the gospel. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to bounce around between 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 1 Corinthians 15, and then we'll spend some time in Romans chapter 6 a little bit. And we'll answer these questions. What is the gospel? Why do we need to obey it? And then how do we obey it? So what is the gospel? Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Paul tells us very clearly what it is. What is the gospel? He says, now I make known to you, brethren, the gospel which I preached to you, which you also received, in which you also stand, and by which you are also saved, if you hold fast the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. So what did Paul preach to the Corinthians? I just gave you the answer. What did he preach to the Corinthians? The gospel. The gospel which I preached to you. So what did he preach? What is the gospel? Look at verse 3. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, that's Peter, and then to the 12, those are the apostles. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain until now, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared to me also. So what is Paul preaching here? Jesus died. Jesus was buried. Jesus was raised. And Jesus appeared. And he appeared to multitudes of people. I mean, Paul says he appeared first to Peter. We know that he appeared to the women who went to the tomb. They went to finish preparing the body after the 3 days were over. And as they approached, they saw the stone that was rolled away, and they saw this angel that was sitting there. In fact, one of them thought that Jesus, who was actually there, was the gardener. And they say, "Where have you laid him?" But they find the stone rolled away, and John gives the account of one of the women running back to the disciples, and then Peter and John going back to the tomb, and they find the tomb empty. They find the grave cloths lying there. Everybody knew that Jesus had died. Everybody knew that. From the centurion who was stationed at the foot of the cross, who was given orders to break the legs of all the criminals. And when he saw that Jesus was already dead, he chose not to break his legs. He didn't know he was fulfilling Scripture, by the way. Go back to Isaiah 53. And so instead, he thrust his spear in his side, and out flowed blood and water. There was no doubt that he was dead. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, they came. Joseph requested the body of Jesus that he might give Jesus a proper burial. Nicodemus brought about 100 pounds of aloes and myrrh with which to prepare the body for burial and wrap it in the linen cloths. And they laid it in Joseph's tomb. It was a brand new tomb. Nobody had ever laid there before. In other words, you would not mistake the body of Jesus for another body that might have been in there. His was the only body ever to be in that tomb. Everybody knew that he would die, had died. Everybody knew that he was buried. And everybody was learning that he was raised on the third day. That's what Paul is preaching. And Paul says, as proof that he was raised from the dead, he began appearing to people. He appeared to Cephas, or Peter. He appeared to the 12. He appears to more than 500 people at one time. Paul is simply giving proof that Jesus was raised from the dead. And he said, you can talk to these people because some of them are still living. Some of them remain until now. Go ask them. They saw him. They have eyewitness testimony. That's what Paul is preaching. And what does Paul call that message of the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus? He calls it the gospel. He says, this is what I delivered to you. So when we look at what the gospel is, it is the fact that Christ died, Christ was buried, Christ was raised, Christ appeared. And all of it according to the Scriptures. Go back and look at Psalm 16, verse 8 and following, and you'll find that this is what the Christ was supposed to suffer. That's what the psalmist records. That's what Peter preaches in Acts chapter 2 when he references Psalm 16 and verse 8. And Jesus fits the description. Jesus is the Christ. That's the conclusion to which Peter came when he preached the sermon, Acts chapter 2, verse 36. And God made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. So what is the gospel? It's the death, it's the burial, it's the resurrection of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of our sins, that we might be saved. So think about that. Why do we obey the gospel? Why should we? Look at Romans chapter 1. Why should we obey the gospel? Well, Romans chapter 1 says that it is the power of God unto salvation. You see, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus is the power of God for our salvation. It's the message, listen to this, it is the message that God uses to call us to salvation. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. Paul identifies that it is the gospel that God uses to call us into fellowship with himself. God uses the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus to call us to salvation. When we look upon the historical facts of Jesus' life, of his death, of his burial, his resurrection. God is saying that that's my power to save you. So because of that, come to me. That's how he calls us. How many of you in here have been called by God? Okay? Every hand ought to go up because you've just been called this morning. If you've never heard the gospel before, you've heard it this morning already. What is the gospel? The death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus for our salvation. That's the gospel. That's what God uses to call us. Everybody in here has been called by God because the gospel has been preached. That's what Paul is saying. And Romans chapter 1, verse 16 says that it is, that Paul says he is not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to those who believe. What if you don't believe in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus? There might be a little retribution. There might be separation on the day that Jesus returns. I say might. I think the odds are about 100%. You see, that's why we obey the gospel, is because God has preached the gospel. God has declared the gospel in his Son. And he says, this is how I want you to come to me, through the gospel. I want you to see the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. I want you to see what it means. I want you to see how I use it to save you from the wages of sin. Romans chapter 3 and verse 23 tells us how many people in this world have ever sinned. How many people in this world have ever sinned? All people. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So who is all? Everybody. How many in this room? All of us have sinned and we've fallen short of the glory of God. But what are the wages of our sin? And everybody has to pay these wages. Death. Romans 6 and verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. So how do we get into Christ? We obey the gospel. We'll talk about that in a moment, but this is what God uses to save us, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus, because he was that sacrifice for our sin. You see, the wages of sin is death, and therefore everybody who sins must pay those wages. You must pay those wages. Now, can you offer yourself as a sacrifice for your own sin? Well, certainly not. You've already sinned. So you're disqualified from being a sacrifice. You are with blemish instead of without blemish. Therefore, you're not qualified to be the sacrifice. Because the only thing that can be sacrificed to God that is acceptable to God is a perfect sacrifice. A sacrifice that is without blemish. And if we've all sinned, we've all got blemishes. Right? So we can't offer ourselves. So we can't die for our own sin. So what do? We look to the one who was without blemish. We look to the spotless Lamb of God. We look to the one who was tempted in every way as we are, yet he never sinned. Therefore, he was qualified to be that sacrifice. That's why John refers to him as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John chapter 1 and verse 29. Because Jesus lived without blemish, he qualifies to be a sacrifice in our place. Oh, aren't you so glad you don't have to go to the cross? Aren't you so glad that you don't have to suffer the wages of sin? You don't have to, because he did. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 20, God made him who knew no sin to be sin, on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. You see, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, but it is also where God declares His own righteousness. And when Jesus goes to the cross in our place, when Jesus pays the wages for sin instead of you and I paying those wages, He became sin so that we might become the righteousness of God. How do we do that? Through the gospel. You see, that's the beauty of the gospel. And that's why we ought to obey the gospel. Because it saves us. From what does it save us? It saves us from our sin. It saves us from ourselves, really. Isn't that good news? You know, that's really what we typically think of when we hear the word gospel. And when you ask people what gospel means, they tell us good news. And it certainly is, right? I mean, from the Greek word, it's euangelion. And it simply means the proclamation of good news, good tidings. And that's what the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus is. It's good news because it saves us from our sins. And that's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 2, by which you are also saved. What is the gospel? It's the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. Why do we obey it? Because it saves us from our sins. It saves us from that eternal destruction that Paul talks about in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 9. Being kept apart from Jesus. That's what our sin does, Isaiah 59 verses 1 and 2. It keeps us separate from Jesus. The gospel reunites us with Christ. Because through the gospel and our obedience to the gospel, we come into Christ. You see? So how? How do you obey the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus? You have to die? You have to die? Yes, you do. Or, if you look at Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 1, you have to realize that in sin you're already dead. How many of you watched the television program, The Walking Dead? Okay, there's some hands that are up here. You guys have problems. But anyway, we'll talk with you guys later, all right? But how many people do you know of who are walking around your neighborhood who are walking dead? How many people in your family do you know who are walking dead? How many people where you work are walking dead? How many people at your school are walking dead? Because you see, it's in sin where we are dead. And so maybe we have to die to sin. Paul says that, Romans chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. What shall we say then? Should we go on sinning that grace may abound? Verse 2 says, absolutely not. How can we who died to sin? So we've got to die, right? How do I obey the gospel? Well, the first thing you got to do, you have to die. The second thing you have to do is, what did Jesus do? He was buried, and therefore we need to be buried. Isn't that what we typically do with a person who has died? We prepare the body, and they're buried. This is the form of teaching in Romans chapter 6, verse 17 and 18. This is the form of teaching to which Paul refers that the Romans had already obeyed from the heart. The Romans had already done these things. They obeyed from the heart that form of teaching, Romans chapter 6, verse 17 and 18. And he says, thanks be to God that though you were slaves of sin, you obeyed from the heart that form of teaching to which you had been committed. And having been freed from sin, do you see what happened when they obeyed that form of teaching? What happens? They are freed from sin. You see, that's what the gospel does. That's why we obey the gospel, because it saves us from sin. You've been freed from sin and you become slaves of righteousness, because in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. And so that's how we do it. We obey from the heart, a form of teaching. What is the form of teaching? Romans 6, verses 3 and 4. That's how we obey. This is the pattern. This is the form. It's in the Greek word, it's tupos. And it simply means a pattern or a form. I've used this illustration before. We've talked about it in Bible classes in different places. But ladies, when you bake a cake, or some guys bake a cake, let me tell you, if you've never had one of Steve Campbell's chocolate cakes, you're missing out. Steve Campbell can bake a cake, all right? But ladies, when you bake a cake, one of the cakes that I like are bundt cakes. You know why? Because you can slice them up nice and easy, grab them in your fingers, they're so easy to eat. I mean, you just, as you're walking by, you just grab a piece and you walk by again and grab another one. You can tell that I've done that a few times. But listen, when you use a bundt pan, how many different shapes, how many different cakes can you bake in one bundt pan? One. Because every time you use that form to bake a cake, it will always come out looking the same. Every single time. Guys, when you use forms in construction, if you're pouring concrete, you build a form. Every time you use that form, pour concrete into that form, every time you use that form, you're going to get the exact same product. Aren't you? Every single time. That's what Paul is talking about here. Obeying from the heart that form, that pattern of teaching to which they had been committed. Now notice he says they obeyed it from the heart. There was conviction with which they obeyed the gospel, that form of teaching. There was some conviction. There was emotion. There was connection there. They knew that what they were obeying was right, and they put their heart into it. It's Acts 2:37. When Peter declared in verse 36 that God made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified, the people listening there were pricked in the heart. They were pierced in the heart, and they asked Peter, "What should we do?" And Peter says, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." As Peter preached this lesson, and as people were responding and recognizing the truth of which Peter was preaching, they were obeying what Peter taught them to do. Peter gave them a form of teaching to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. What for? For the forgiveness of your sins. You're beginning to make some connections. And so these people obeyed from the heart what Peter told them. They were pricked in the heart. They knew that they needed to know God, and they knew that they needed to obey the gospel. In Romans chapter 6, verse 3, "Or do you not know? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death?" You see the death? "Therefore, we have been buried with him." How? "Through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if..." What's the biggest word in the Bible? If. You folks are learning that. "If we've become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection." You see, there is your pattern. There is the form. There is the gospel. Notice the parallel between what Paul preaches in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 5 through 9, and what Paul says in Romans chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. He says that in the gospel, Christ died. In the pattern, we die. Or we're already dead. In the gospel, Christ was buried. In the pattern, we're buried with Christ in baptism. In the gospel, Christ was raised from the dead on the third day. In the pattern, we're raised from the water on the third day. Well, I'm just kidding about the third day there. We really don't hold you under that long. Some people need to be held under a little bit longer than others. But we're raised. And listen to this. It's the same power. No, this is important. Look at verse 4. It's the same power that raised Jesus from the dead, that raises us from the watery grave of baptism. You see, this is the pattern. This is the how. Christ died, we die. Christ was buried, we're buried with him through baptism. And Christ was raised, and the same power that brought Christ out of the grave is what raises us to walk in newness of life. Now that's some amazing power, isn't it? But that's the power of God for salvation. And what is the power of God for salvation? Romans 1 and verse 16, Paul's not ashamed of it. It's the gospel. You see that? That's the gospel. That's what the gospel is. That's why we ought to obey it. And that's how we do it. Listen to this. Listen to this reasoning. If the gospel is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus, okay? And is the gospel the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus? Okay, if that's the gospel, and if the pattern for us to follow imitates the death, the burial, and the resurrection, then it stands to reason that baptism is the pattern by which we obey the gospel. Does that make sense? I mean, I'm trying to be clear. Paul is very clear here. So why would we want to obey it? In order to be saved from our sin. Because those who don't obey the gospel, to those people, God will deal out retribution. God will offer eternal destruction and eternal separation from him on the day that Jesus returns. Now, you don't want that to be you, do you? You don't want that to be your family, do you? You don't want that to be your friends or your coworkers, do you? Listen, God doesn't want anybody to perish. God wants everybody to come to repentance. God wants everybody to hear the gospel. That's why he gave us the Great Commission, that everyone might hear the gospel. And he wants you to hear the gospel. He wants you to be called. And all of you have been called this morning. Because every human being has two great needs. First of all is to know God. And second of all is to obey his gospel. The two greatest needs that everybody in this room has is that we know God, all on an ever deepening and growing level, and that we all obey the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's what God desires for us more than anything. So I guess the question is, when 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 8 says that God will deal out retribution to those who don't know him and those who don't obey the gospel, do you really believe that God will do what he says he will do? Do you really believe God will deal out retribution? He said he would. If you want to avoid the retribution, if you want to avoid being separated from God for all eternity, if you want to avoid paying the consequences of your sin all on your own, then we need to obey the gospel. And you can do that right now. Perhaps you've obeyed the gospel, but you're living like the Romans, where we've obeyed the gospel, but we're continuing in sin. And today you can repent of that. Confess it if you need to. Seek the prayers of your brothers and sisters in your family here. But don't miss out on the eternal glory spent with God and His Son. You've heard the gospel. God has called you through His gospel. God has invited you to obey the gospel and to live a life that's worthy of the gospel. And so I invite you to do what you need to do right now to be right with God and to seek His righteousness. Let's stand and sing together.